Good morning. Welcome to Providence United Methodist Church. Grateful for your presence and so glad that you decided to plug in with us with our live stream. For some of you who want to get to it fast, it is providenceumc.net/live. And we love the fact that you are plugging in. We pray that we would be a blessing to all of you. I miss all of you and look forward to a time when we can get back together, and some of that information will be forthcoming. Please join me in our call to worship. The Lord has been our refuge and our keeper. It is God who has kept us from falling and has saved our lives. Let our thanks and praise resound throughout this place of worship. Let our love and our gratitude be shown in all that we do. Open your hearts and your spirits to God this day. Lord, be with us and place your hand of healing in our lives. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Please join me in our opening prayer. Source of all creation, maker of the world and everything in it, you are never far from each one of us. We come into your house seeking you. O giver of life and breath, reveal yourself to us, dwell with us, and abide in us. We live because of you. We hope because of you. In the name of Jesus Christ, in whom we live, in the Spirit of truth, who abides in us, and all of God's people said, amen.
Good morning. I'm Mary Elliott, and I'm bringing you the children's message this morning. Have you ever had something that really gave you comfort? Something you were excited about to show people and to tell people about? My favorite color is pink. And when I went away to college, my dad and I went shopping for my stuff, and I found a pink comforter. It was big and bulky, and it was just pink. It didn't have any flowers on it. It didn't have any frills on it. It was just pink, and I loved it. So I took it to school, and it served me well, and then I brought it home. And so I was thinking about it this morning, and I've had that comforter for 36 years. And I still use it a lot. And it brings me comfort every time I pull it out. And when my kids were sick, or they didn't feel good, or Greg didn't feel good, I would always pull it out for them. I'd say, do you want to use my pink comforter? Because it'll make you feel better. And it always has. In today's Bible reading, Jesus tells his disciples that he's not going to be around forever, but that he's sending his Holy Spirit to live in our hearts and be our comforter. It's such an awesome gift that he wants us to experience it. He wants us to appreciate it. But he also wants us to share it with our friends and family so that they can feel that God is with them just like we feel it. So this week, find the things that give you comfort. Share it with your family and with your friends when you see them. But don't forget to share God's love with them also so that they can have the comfort that you have in Jesus. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for sending us Jesus and your Holy Spirit to be with us and give us comfort. Help us to spread that love and comfort to others. We love you. Amen.
Our scripture reading comes from Psalm 66, verses 8 through 20. Bless our God, O peoples, and let the sound of his praise be heard, who has kept us among the living, and has not let our feet slip For you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us as silver is tried. You brought us to the net. You laid burdens on our backs, and you let people ride over our heads. We went through fire and through water, yet you have brought us out to a spacious place. I will come into your house with burnt offerings. I will pay you my vows, those that my lips utter. And my mouth promise when I was in trouble. I will offer to you burnt offerings of fatlings. With the smoke of the sacrifice of rams, I will make an offering unto bulls and goats. Selah. Come and hear, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what he has done for me. I cried aloud to him, and he was extolled with my tongue. If I have cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But truly, God has listened, and he has given heed to the words of my prayers. Blessed be God, because he has not rejected my prayers or removed his steadfast love from me. May the Lord add a rich blessing to the reading, the hearing of God's holy word. May it sink deep down and bring forth much fruit. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We're going to have a few songs. Cry of my heart and open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Good morning. So I'd love to read a passage from Psalm 146 for you. It says, praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. So this morning, I encourage you to praise the Lord, to join us in song. Whether you're a vocalist or not, you can still sing, you can hum along, and it really lifts our spirits. Think about how important music is in our lives. Usually we have it on in the car, we have it on in our homes, it's on in stores, and there's something powerful about music, but something even more powerful begins when we praise the Lord and lift our voices in song. So let's do that together.
It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of
Good morning again. Dr. Moon will be our preacher for today. But I want you to understand that Bishop Sharma Lewis wanted all of the district superintendents to bring a word to all of their congregations, a word of hope, a word of challenge, and a word of encouragement. So Dr. Moon will be our speaker, and he will also be leading us in our second reading. But let me tell you a little bit about him for some of you who have plugged in and may not know about Dr. Moon. He was born in Nashville, Tennessee, and was raised in Rockville, Maryland. He graduated from the University of Washington in Seattle with a degree in aeronautical and astronautical engineering. Wow. Following graduation, he served as a naval flight officer aboard the aircraft carrier USS Kitty Hawk and USS Ranger. In 1988, he left the United States Navy and he went to Union PSCE, and I like hearing that because that's the school that I graduated from. And he served in many capacities, but he's been our district superintendent for 5.5 years. So let's listen for Dr. Moon.
Well, good morning, Richmond District. It is such a treat and privilege to be with all of you today and to have a little time with you in worship. And before we jump into the text and into our reading, I just want to offer a shout out to all of you as churches. This has been a tough couple months and weeks, and you all have just been incredible. You have been flexible, you have been creative, you have been persistent, and you have made things work despite all the challenges. I am just so impressed by the many ways you have done so many things. But I also want to offer a special shout out to our clergy. My goodness, you all have been flexible, you have been innovative, you have made things work, you have been persistent, and you've done it with such a great spirit and such a great attitude. And I gotta tell you how appreciative and thankful I am to you, and what a gift and privilege it has been to work with you these weeks, even in the midst of so many challenges. You all are just awesome. Churches, clergy, and you have brought it in a very difficult time. So please hear my words of appreciation and thanks for all that you have been doing and the hard work you have been offering. This morning, we come to the lectionary text, which is the 14th chapter of the book of John. And I invite you to hear these words as Jesus offers us a description of the role of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Will you listen now for the word of God? If you love me, keep my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Lord, as your word is offered and proclaimed on this day, it is our humble prayer that your spirit, the spirit of which we proclaim this day, will fall upon me and all of us in a generous way, that we might understand and take hold of the truth of that which we proclaim this day. For we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, friends, let me just begin with a modest confession of my bias. You need to know, I am not really a fan of bumper stickers. It's not a huge issue for me, but I've just never been one to put it out there on the back end of my car. But a couple of years back, I made this notable exception. You also need to know that my family is a family of dog lovers. We all have dogs, and some have lots of dogs. But I saw this great bumper sticker that simply said this: wag more, bark less. Now, I've been a church pastor for 30 years, so I also admit that I had some attraction to that message and all of that. So I took the plunge and I got the bumper sticker. I put it on the back of my car and life was very good. But I need to tell you that my wife is also not really a bumper sticker kind of person. So imagine my surprise when one day I walk out to my car and there's another bumper sticker placed by my wife next to my Wag More Bark Less sticker. And she had put on a sticker right next to it that simply said, "Woof." Now, admittedly, I have a bias about bumper stickers, but that still had a pretty good message. But I also, when I think about the whole bumper sticker thing, I think of Dallas Willard and his commentary on our tendency in our contemporary world to embrace a sort of light bumper sticker message theology and philosophy for life. And it's true, we have become increasingly attracted and drawn to poignant phrases and tweets. And certainly they're nice messages, but as he points out, they are nice, but you run into trouble when you actually try to live your life by them. But that certainly doesn't stop us. We often find ourselves in this day and age, in all these tweets and phrases, going light in our philosophy, light in what we believe. We find ourselves celebrating and passing on phrases that go down so smooth, phrases that don't ask too much of us. But then if we're honest, we recognize those phrases also enable us to maintain a nominal faith, a nominal life. But of course, there's the problem. If we're honest, we might find that this light philosophy and belief system, it dresses up nicely, sure, but there's just not much power to it. And so many of us are seeking exactly that, power. Power to be changed, power to change, power to make a difference in the world. That's our mission statement. We're supposed to transform the world. And we're all seeking the power to do exactly that. And we're finding that this light philosophy just can't bring it. In fact, it makes me think of a Super Bowl commercial, award-winning Super Bowl commercial that came out just a couple of years ago. But as you watch this, let me ask if your spiritual life sometimes feels like this. Well, we laugh at all that, but perhaps not too long when we think about how often that's exactly happened to us. We try to bring our faith to bear with similar results. But you see, this morning, when we open up the 14th chapter of John, we see a very different story. We see a story that speaks to genuine spiritual power. Now, most of you are going to be looking at the sermon on the 17th. Some of you are going to be looking at it at Pentecost, but they both offer similar themes. In our quest for transformative power, whether it be Pentecost or today at John 14, they both bring it and offer a picture, a much needed picture that all of us need today. So today what I'd like to do is look deeply into this passage about the Holy Spirit to demonstrate this fundamental truth. We're going to briefly look at three things that demonstrate the way that when you and I go a bit deeper with the text, it creates a platform that offers opportunity for us to find the spiritual power for which so many of us are hungry. But before we get there, let me offer just a brief side journey about how it is that going deeper is transformative. Paul used to say that in his writings. He would speak of the way when we go deeper, when we understand the very character of God, when we come to know God in a deeper way, it transforms our life. And in fact, Charles Spurgeon wrote a sermon about that 160 years ago when he was 20 years old. I won't go through the whole sermon, but his concept was helpful. He reminded us that when we do things like what we're doing right now, opening the text, coming into worship, being in prayer, that something holy and sacred happens in that moment. For on one hand, we come into the presence of God and we are humbled. We feel small. But then ironically, on the other hand, we are exposed to the expansive, infinite character of God. And we are both reduced in stature and raised up at the same time. And in that gap, that is a holy and sacred transformative space where the change we're searching for, where it happens uniquely. Right? Any teacher will tell you the same thing. This is the place where we learn. A humble heart is a teachable heart and ready to hear something great and something moving. That's why over the years I've had sort of a phrase I've shared with my congregations. I will often say to them, friends, if you heard a good sermon today, it's your fault. And you probably understand what that's saying. A good sermon is often dependent on the attitude you and I bring into the room. If we walk into the room convinced, you know, that preacher's not going to say anything I haven't heard today before, likely he or she will not. But if you come in with a hungry heart that is honestly seeking some hope, some faith, a genuine word from the Lord, very often you will find yourself in this holy and sacred and transformative place. And in that vein, let me continue to offer what is admittedly too brief of a description of these three places in the text where we are invited to a deeper place where that change of which we speak uniquely occurs. First, did you hear how the text invites us to release a generic understanding of the Holy Spirit, to understand a more specific understanding? Now, let's just be honest and confess that most of us are more comfortable with the wider descriptions. Catch the Spirit, moving with the Spirit. It's easier to accept that wider language. But as it becomes more specific, we tend to struggle. In fact, I think of the story of Fred Craddock. He preached years ago as he described Pentecost. And in a way, I wish I could duplicate his great voice. But he talked about how, you know, Pentecost is a great word when we hear it as a noun, Pentecost. He said, we start to get a little uncomfortable when the noun becomes an adjective, Pentecostal, right? It's an adjective, a word looking for a noun to modify. But look at what this text does. It doesn't take the broad force. It makes it specific. And Jesus tells us that the Holy Spirit has personality and the Holy Spirit has purpose. He says the Holy Spirit has purpose and personality. And even more, these things are brought to bear upon you and me and our souls. And it is the will of the Trinity to make the purpose and personalities essentially the same, to bring it into conformance, to bring it into unity. And you see it in the word choice in the text. You know, our translation for the morning has Jesus calling the Spirit the advocate. But you may be familiar with the fact that the Greek term is paraclete. And I love the way translators have struggled over centuries to pin this word down. Literally, it means the one who walks beside. But we translate it as helper, encourager, advocate, counselor, and the list goes on. Of course, the Holy Spirit does all those things. The point that Jesus is making is that he is going to send another advocate. And the Spirit is here with you and me to do with us what Jesus did with the disciples as he walked beside them when he walked this earth. Do you hear that? Jesus is sending the advocate to do what he did when he walked with his disciples. So the Spirit is not just a mighty wind that blows, it is that. But it is the Spirit walking beside you to challenge you and encourage you and counsel you and guide you, just as Jesus did. And not only that, the Spirit gives you the power to do the things that we are called to do. And that takes us and segues to the second thing that this text invites us in this adventure. The Scripture here invites you and me to understand God's presence in a much richer way. You know, most of us are accustomed to speaking of God being with us, God being with you. And of course, that's a foundational message of the Scriptures all throughout. God is Emmanuel, God with us, and that is to be celebrated and affirmed. It's a foundation that the Scriptures rest upon in many ways. But did you hear what this text said? That God is not just with us in a generic sense. God is with us intimately. That's one of the main themes of the reading for today. The way that God through the Spirit is right here. And the text uses family language to describe that relationship. Jesus said, "I will not leave you as orphans." In a verse we didn't have a chance to include in the reading, Jesus speaks about our obedience. We'll get to that in a little bit. But Jesus says that we will come and make our home with them. Make our home with them. You hear that? God is not just with us. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit take us in as orphans, and they make their home with you and with me. And generic phrases just don't capture the wonder. But I invite you to think about that. God, who spoke the universe into being. Christ, who died on a cross and is risen for you and me to give us hope. The Spirit, who desires all in the world to come to a saving faith in Christ. This same God passionately desires to make a home with me. You know, friends, we're in a world where we're spending more and more time alone, more and more time in social isolation and distancing, and we're sort of sheltering in place at home. But you see what this text is saying? The Lord of the universe wants to come make his home with me. And that kind of quarantine beats Netflix binging anytime, amen? Well, you know, it's so far so good. This deeper dive with the text, it reveals the wondrous love and purpose and presence. And it is a wondrous source of encouragement for us in these challenging times. But while there's abundant encouragement here, there's also a profound challenge in the words. Because Jesus calls us here on our often superficial understanding of the word love. I mean, you don't have to work hard to understand that we in our culture often drift naturally to a more nominal understanding of this word, a lighter understanding of this world. And not all of that is bad. But again, Jesus calls us on it here. In the very first verse, he says, "If you love me, keep my commands." And just to make sure we heard it clearly, he closes our reading for the day with very similar words when he says, "Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me." I mean, that's a little bit harder, isn't it? He's saying that the one who really loves Jesus is the one who does what Jesus says. I mean, it's kind of like that illustration that so many of us have heard over the years at stewardship sermons. It's echoed by TV financial folks and financial planners, whether Dave Ramsey or Susie Orman. They say that we can really tell our priorities not by what we say are most important things, but you can really tell a person's priorities by what's on their calendar and what's on their financial statement, bank statement, credit card statement, you name it. That's where the rubber meets the road. Now we have to be very careful at this point and sensitive to the many in this day and age and time who have lost their jobs and don't have income. Many are struggling just to pay the bills, and we have to hear that concern. But the premise also generally holds, because Jesus said the same thing in the Sermon on the Mount. He said, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven." See, it's not that hard. If we love Jesus, we will obey Jesus. Now, this, of course, doesn't mean that obedience earns the love of Christ. Of course not. But it does mean that when we love Jesus, we'll submit and we'll surrender. We will yield our will for his will. But those are hard words to swallow today. Surrender, submit, obey. And honestly, when most of us hear the word obey, many of us just bristle. But what if we, in keeping with them, just keep going a little bit deeper in our understanding? And I invite you to think about the power, the transformational power of obedience and surrender as a motivation to do what Christ has called us to do. And I'm prayerful and hopeful that a story will help us think about that. Many of you know that before I came into the ministry, I was a Navy flyer. And I will never forget the first time I was ever strapped into a tactical jet. The trainer was an old one, and it was designed for people who are a lot shorter than me. And when I climbed into that cockpit, my shoulders barely squeezed into the sides of it. I couldn't move my shoulders. My helmet hit the top of the canopy. I could move my hands, my feet, and my neck, and that was it. In addition, they strap you in so tight that it feels like you can't move at all. And it was 95 degrees in the Pensacola sun. Now, I'm not prone to claustrophobia, but I gotta tell you, I started having those kind of thoughts as we taxied out onto the runway. But you know, when we got there, everything changed. Because when we put the power up and released the brakes and headed off the runway, you realized what the jet could do. You suddenly realize that you are strapped in to one of the most powerful machines in the world. And when I found out what was the power that was at my hands, the things we could do, all thoughts of claustrophobia just evaporated because I was strapped into something so powerful. I have found that obedience to Christ is very much like that. Perhaps at first, putting on the straps of his call and commands, it feels restrictive. It is never easy to serve before you are served. It's never easy to deny yourself in this contemporary sea of narcissism in which we find ourselves. It's never easy to seek God's kingdom first. It's never easy to give sacrificially in this consumerist age, and the list goes on and on. But when you strap on the obedience to Christ and his will, and you put this thing on the end of the runway, and you put up the power, you find out what you can do when you take this machine called discipleship for a ride. And the good news, brothers and sisters, is that you don't do it alone. Our text reminds us that the Holy Spirit is there with all the power you need for this ride. So friends, let me just say, I don't like bumper stickers. They're cute, but as much as we try, you just can't live off them. But you can live off this word. And this morning we have been reminded, friends, of deeper things. That the Holy Spirit is not just some vague general force, but the Spirit has power and purpose and personality to do in you what Jesus did with his disciples so long ago. We are reminded that God is not just with you, but the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, passionately desire to not leave you as an orphan and to make their home with you and with me. And friends, we're reminded that it's not enough to say, I love Jesus. More than words are required. We actually have to do what the man taught us to do. When we obey, we are loving our Lord. Not to earn that love, it's already there. But when we do, we are strapping onto the one thing that could transform us and the world. So friends, let me just say, bumper stickers aren't bad, but we could do better. Let us pray. Lord, I thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit and the things you want to do in every single one of us, the power you give us, even though we don't deserve it. Help us to yield to your will. Help us to understand the wonder of your love and enable us to do what we cannot do on our own. As we give you all the thanksgiving, all the praise, and all our hope in the strong name of Jesus. And all God's people say, Amen. Friends, may God bless you, and may you go in peace.
Dear friends, we want to thank Dr. Moon for sharing a wonderful word with us. But I wanted to take a moment just to say to so many of you that have been so faithful, who continue to send in your tithes and your offerings in the midst of this challenging season. So I wanted to offer prayers over our offering. And I believe that God can sustain God's church, but he needs our help. So let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of giving and receiving these gifts. And we know that they are much needed. The lights have to go on. We still need air conditioning, heat, until you bring us back together. But help us to take the love and the spirit of giving that we have experienced in this time and throughout our lives and allow it to become contagious. Let the spirit of giving permeate our entire congregation. And may the Holy Spirit guide our thoughts, our words, and our deeds as we seek to live generously. Amen.
So to follow up with Dr. Moon's message about the Spirit of the Lord, we're going to sing a couple of songs that really talk about the presence of God and this, the Spirit who we know is walking with us.
Presence of the Lord is in this place. I can
Want to thank everyone for participating in worship today and making this great day possible. But God is good, amen? God is indeed good. Please receive your benediction. May the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift your countenance and grant us all God's great peace. Be at peace. God bless.